hesitation, and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear the threshing floor, to gather the wheat into his granary, for the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated.
The mighty Messiah turns out to be
the gentle Jesus. Rather than a military leader lording over his subjects, we instead meet a rather modest man who wades into muddy water, choosing to be a companion to those he has come to serve. The two conflicting images of the Holy Spirit included in the gospel underscore the difference between John's expectation and the reality of Jesus. For John the Baptist, the Holy Spirit is like a refiner's fire, representing the judgment of God. But when the Holy Spirit comes upon Jesus, it's like a dove. Like the dove in Noah's Ark, who marked the end of God's judgment. In other words, the fire God, the ire God, is replaced by the dove God, the love God. Now, in all the gospel accounts describing the baptism of Jesus, there's one question that remains unanswered in all of the accounts. Why was Jesus baptized? Right? Why did he need to be baptized? After all, according to John, baptism is for the purpose of repentance and forgiveness of sins. But Jesus is the Son of God, is he not? Jesus is God. So what did Jesus need to repent of? What did he need to be forgiven for? Well, for the same reason that he was born in a manger. For the same reason that he eats with prostitutes and tax collectors. For the same reason that he cries and he prays and he sleeps in a garden and that he dies a painful, very human death. Jesus comes to be like us so that we can grow to be more like him. Jesus, you see, is baptized into our humanity so that we can in turn be baptized into his divinity. You know, in the Eastern Orthodox tradition, those who are baptized in the same font, they all become siblings. They are considered the same flesh and blood. They are kin to one another. So in that sense, Jesus became siblings with all those in the crowd with whom he was baptized in the River Jordan. And when we are baptized into Christ in the waters of baptism, we too become brothers and sisters with each other in and with Christ. The personal name we receive is important, but much, much more important than that is the spiritual name that we receive. Christian, bearer of Christ, brother and sister of Christ, in Christ. There's a story about how once a pastor was in the middle of performing a wedding ceremony and he was about to meet the couple through their vows, but he totally forgot the name of the groom. I can't, not that I can relate to that, but it happened. Trying to cover the awkward moment, the pastor asked the groom with great solemnity, "With what name were you baptized?" And the groom, taken aback, paused a bit, and then with great confidence he responded, "I was baptized with the name of the Lord Jesus Christ." Didn't help the pastor much, but at least the guy understood the meaning of baptism. Now, I think one of the most important things, I think the most important thing about our gospel reading today is how it ends. It transforms, you see, from thunder to thunder, from an abstract, awesome God to a fragile, flesh and blood God. The heavenly God decides to become earthly and concrete in bushes that burn and babies that burp and burst that baptize. And it is then that the God of creation responds in a very particular way. God is delighted. Absolutely delighted. In the third chapter of Luke, the 22nd verse, the voice of God speaks once again, but unlike the stereophonic, megaphonic voice of Psalm 29, this voice is warm. This voice is welcoming. You are my son, the beloved, and with you, I am well pleased. To the man in the mud, the son who had become a servant, God speaks. Even before Jesus has done anything noteworthy or worthwhile, God praises him. God affirms that Jesus is truly precious, that he is unique, that he is loved, not for what he does, but for who he is. In this baptismal scene, God echoes the divine light and pleasure that was expressed at the very beginning of creation. Remember? Remember what happened at the very beginning of creation and the creation after the creation of the sea and the dry land. God said, what? It is good. At the creation of the light and the dark and the star and the sun and the moon, God said, what? It is good. After the creation of the birds and the animals and the plants and the trees and the fish and the sea, God said,
it is good.
Very good. And after the creation of man and woman in God's image, God said,
it is good.
It is. Very good. I heard some other things. That was not God. That was it. And after the baptism of Jesus, after this total immersion into the human condition, God says, this is good. This is delightful. This is the beloved who gives me great pleasure. This is very, very good. And so it is with each and every one of us. When we are baptized, we too are blessed as the beloved. We too bring pleasure to God. The Greek word for baptism, to dip, to immerse, to submerge, to saturate. Baptism for all of us is the bath of the beloved. When God takes pleasure in saturating us with water, saturating us with grace, saturating us with blessing. And through this saturation of blessing and belonging, we become the beloved. Those set apart by God, by God's love, to become love to the entire world. So remember your baptisms, my brothers and sisters in Christ. Remember that you are all blessed. Remember that you belong. Remember that you are beloved. And remember that it is the gracious God who is taking delight, taking pleasure in who and whose you are and in who you are becoming. This profound gift, it changes us. This profound gift, it defines us. This profound gift is what we have to share with the entire world. And how can we do anything but be a blessing to others? How can we do anything else but to find and name the beloved and to give others a sense of belonging to God's family? This is the gift of this day. This is the call of this day. And it is very,